There's a word for us this afternoon, and it is found in the book of Ephesians, chapter 6, verses 10 through 20. Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20, reads in the New King James Version of the Holy Bible, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Therefore, take up the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all, to stand. Stand therefore, having girded your waist with truth, having put on the breastplate of righteousness, and having shod your feet with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, with which you will be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked one. And take the helmet of salvation, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, being watchful to this end, with all perseverance and supplication for all the saints, and for me, that utterance may be given to me, that I may be open, that I may open my mouth boldly to make known the mystery of the gospel, for which I am an ambassador in chains, that in me I may speak boldly as I want to speak. Amen.
Amen.
I have just read to you Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 20, and then I would like to share words with us this afternoon from the subject, "The World Needs Jesus." Amen.
Amen.
I want to talk to us from the subject, the World Needs Jesus. Usually, we plan our sermons and five in advance. I try is to plan our sermons perhaps a full year in advance. But sometimes things happen in the world that will change even the best made plans. And we are living at a time now, which is one of those times where it is necessary that to yield as the Spirit leads us, perhaps, in a different direction. And so today's sermon was supposed to be a continuation of our series about bring back our voice, but instead we are going to be preaching a different word this afternoon from the subject, "The World Needs Jesus." The world needs Jesus goes without saying. Everywhere you go, our world is in turmoil. There's trouble at home, and there is trouble abroad. There's racial hatred. There's all kinds of turmoil and divisions here at home, close to us. All of us are witnesses to the mindless killings of several young African American men in this country, when it is clear that they committed no capital offenses. We don't know all the details. Like some people like to say, we don't know everything that happened. And that is true. We don't know all the details, but we do know this, that the offenses that, if any, that they may have committed, as far as we can see, were not capital offenses. And yet, every day, we turn on the television other young person killed many times at the hands of law enforcement officers and sometimes at the hands of pretenders to law enforcement. But whatever the case may be, as we behold this, we are also witnesses to the terrible tragedy that took place in Dallas just about a week ago when some individual took it upon himself in the midst of a peaceful parade to pick out and to start shooting police officers who had done him no harm. And all through this week, we have witnessed funeral after funeral after funeral of these police officers who got up one day to do their work, not knowing that that will be the last day that they would spend on this earth. It is in light of these things that are happening at home, and even the things that are happening abroad, that we share a word with us today, reminding us that the world needs Jesus. Just a few days ago, we all saw on the television once again how an individual in France decided to take a truck and run the truck at maximum speed through a crowd of people, and by the time it was all said and done, he had killed 84 people, including 10 children who had just gone on vacation, perhaps, with their parents. They were minding their business, and none of whom knew him, and he certainly did not know them. All over the world, from Belgium to France, to Nigeria, to Uganda, to just south of us in Venezuela, it doesn't matter where you look. Everywhere you look, you'll find our world groaning under the weight of evil that seems to have pervaded the entire world, and certainly we are exposed to at a much higher level. And as we look at evil everywhere, some of us are waiting to see what the government is going to do. But the truth of the matter is that our government does not know what to do. And there is no government that knows what to do. Because what do you do to deter a person from committing a crime or from unleashing mayhem on innocent parties when he himself has already determined that he will die? Perhaps to prevent another person from running over people in the streets, we may decide to now start building streets in America with concrete barriers so that people cannot run over innocent people. But we realize that there is no end to what the devil is capable of doing, and if you think you have solved one problem, you just attack another way. And in the midst of all of this, we have to wonder, what all can the government do to protect us in the face of these great dangers that we face? The dangers are not always from outside terrorists. Sometimes they are from inside terrorists. They are from those who go to our children's schools and open fire on them in the cafeteria as they eat in their colleges. It is from those who go to movie theaters and right in the middle of the movie begin to shoot innocent citizens. And what is it that we can do to fight at this idea that is in the hearts of men, that it is okay that life is so cheap that we can wake up one day and just then kill hundreds and scores of people who have done us no harm. Listen, church, it is in the midst of all of this that I am convinced, beyond every iota of doubt, that the world needs Jesus. The world needs Jesus. Since our leaders don't know what to do, let us tell them what to do. The world needs Jesus. And unfortunately, the very Jesus that the world needs is the same Jesus that the world is pushing away, trying to eliminate from our sight. But the Bible tells us in John chapter 3 that God did not send Jesus into the world to condemn the world, but he sent him into the world that the world through him might be saved. And so knowing this, let me remind us that the world needs Jesus. Jesus is the solution to the problems of the world. He's not just the solution to the problems of the world today, but he has always been the solution to the problems of the world. The Bible says concerning him that he was indeed the Lamb that was slain even before the foundation of the world. Before this world was created, God knew that this world would fall into sin and turmoil and trouble. And so God provided an answer, and that answer was in his Son, our Lord Jesus Christ. The world needed Jesus in the beginning, and the world still needs Jesus today. In the days of the Apostle Paul, the world needed Jesus because the world was in turmoil even at that time. When Paul wrote the book of Ephesians, he was in prison. He wrote it in prison because the world even then was a troubled world. Throughout Paul's writings, as you read, you find that people were persecuted for their faith, killed for their faith, trouble on every hand. When Jesus preached the Sermon on the Mount, the Bible says he stood and he looked at the multitude of the people. And the multitude of the people were going around. They were ridden with diseases, with disabilities. They were possessed by demons. They were like sheep without a shepherd. Because even back then, the world needed Jesus. And today, church, I just want to remind you that the world needs Jesus, that you need Jesus. You need him, young people, to protect you at school. You need him to protect you when you drive. You need him to protect him when you go to parties or clubs or wherever it is that you go. You need Jesus to be with you. And without Jesus, we are all sitting ducks for the next person who decides that it is his desire to end our lives. So Paul was writing to this church at Ephesus. And when he was writing to them, he shared some thoughts with them about this world that we live in, this evil world. And since evil is not new, let me remind you of some of the things that he shared so that you too will be able to apply the word of God as you also face evil in your life, because evil is everywhere. And in the text, Paul begins by saying to the people at Ephesus, he says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil." He said, "Be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might." He said that because in the face of evil, wherever there is evil, there is a need for strength. Wherever there is evil, there will be attacks, there will be affliction, there will be suffering. And Paul wanted the Ephesians to know that they needed to be strong in the face of evil that was everywhere. And from that verse of scripture, or those verses, we will draw the first point of today's sermon. And the first point of today's sermon is that every believer has power in this evil world. I said we live in an evil world. There is danger. There is evil everywhere. There is evil in schools, in elementary schools, in middle schools, in high schools, in universities, in junior colleges. There is evil in the mall, evil on the road. There is evil on the battlefront. There is evil everywhere. But I want you to know that every believer has power in this evil world. Yes, even though there is evil in the world, God has not left you powerless in the face of the evils of the world. So Paul wanted the people at Ephesus to know that. So he said to them, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. And I want to say to us today that every believer has power in this evil world because we have the person of the Lord on our side. We have the person of the Lord on our side. Paul said, be strong in the Lord. May I just change that a little bit and say that we ought to be strong in our connection with the Lord. We have the person of the Lord on our side. But not only do we have the person of the Lord on our side, but Paul tells them, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. May I remind us that we not only have the person of the Lord on our side, but we also have the power of the Lord on our side. I love the words of Dr. Warren Wiersbe, put it very, very well. And let me quote to you what he wrote about the evil in this world. Warren Wiersbe said that sooner or later, every believer discovers that the Christian life is a battleground, not a playground, and that he faces an enemy who is much stronger than he is, apart from the Lord. He said that the Christian life is not a playground, but it is a battleground. It is amazing to me that many Christians, many people in the church, think that the Christian life is a playground. In this Christianity that we are in, it's not a playground, it is a battleground. And the reason we know it is a battleground is because there is somebody operating in this world to do evil. Paul warned the Ephesians. He said that this person that is operating in the world to do evil, he is stronger than we are. The devil is stronger than you. He's stronger than us apart from Christ. And that is why the power that we have against evil, the power that we have for this evil world, it is not in me or in you, but the power that we have is in Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. I don't care how righteous you think you live your life. I don't care how many times you say you read in the Bible or whatever. The power that we have in this world is not in you, but it is in our Lord Jesus Christ. I've shared with you many times, I'm going to speed through the text, that listen, Satan, our struggle with Satan, our fight with Satan, is like a boxing match. It is like a boxing match. The thing about Satan is that Satan doesn't care if he knocks you out in the first round or the 15th round. The only thing he's concerned about is that at the end of the day, he will knock you out. So you can fight him in your own power. Satan is patient. He's been around a long time. He's not in a hurry like some of us are. And some of us are in such a hurry, we run right into his track. And it is good to move fast if you know where you are going. Y'all didn't hear me? It is good to move fast if you know where you are going. So some of us are just running fast, but we are running fast in the wrong direction. And the truth of the matter is that Satan doesn't mind when he's going to knock you out. He can knock you out in the first round if you are careless, but if you think you are stubborn, he's patient enough to wait for you until the 15th round. Yeah. Amen. Amen. I just want you to know that you are not powerless in this world. As you face evil in this world, I want each and every one of us to know that we are not powerless. We have power in this evil world, but that power comes from our Lord Jesus Christ. And it is in him and in him alone that we can find the power to live in this world of evil. The world today needs Jesus. But I found out in the text, not only that every believer has power in this evil world, but that every believer has persecutors in this evil world. We are under attack by the devil, and we are under attack by the demons. Paul said to the church at Ephesus, he said, put on the whole armor of God in verse 11, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. He was telling them that in this world that we have some persecutors. We have those who want to do evil to us. We have those who want to attack us. The Bible said the devil comes not but to steal, to kill, and to destroy. So don't play with Satan, because at the end of the day, Satan is not coming to play with you. The Bible told us that he comes to kill, to steal, and to destroy. That is why Satan kills babies. The other day in France, there was a young boy. We found out he was 10 years old, I believe, or 11, from Texas, from Austin, Texas. He was one of those that died in France. He was a little boy, just 11 years old. But when Satan wanted to spill blood, when Satan wanted to kill, he did not have mercy even on a child. I thought I'd better say that, because some of our children act as if there is no Satan. They act like Satan is not after them. They act like Satan won't bother them. But young children, I want you to know clearly that Satan is after you. And he's not just after you, but his plan is to kill you. His plan is to steal from you. His plan is to destroy your life. No matter how young you think you are. A lot of you here, you are already over 11 years old. And that little boy, he was 11 years old. He was enjoying himself on vacation with his family when Satan sent a crazy man with a truck to run away. You know how that boy died? Let me not talk about it. It is too gruesome. Let's go on. But I just want you to know that every believer has persecutors in the world. And a persecutor is somebody who has made up his mind to attack you. The person who has made up his mind that you are the target of his hatred. And we are under attack by the devil. Paul told the people of Ephesus that they had power in this evil world. But he went on not just to tell them about the power that they had, but he told them about how to use that power. And church, I'm just trying to tell you that you have power, but you have to know how to use it, and you have to know who to use the power against. And so Paul told them, as we continue to go on in the text in verse 12, he said, for we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this age, against spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Paul had already told them that you have one enemy. Your main enemy in this world is the devil. Your main enemy in this world is not the sister in the church who said something about you. Your main enemy in this in this world is not your husband who refused to eat your soup. Your main enemy in this world is not your friend in school who spread a rumor about you. Your main enemy in this world, young people, is not that popular person in school who tries to bully you. That's not your main enemy in the world. The main enemy we have in this world is the devil himself. And the devil has a two-part strategy in doing evil in this world. The first part of Satan's strategy, as he does evil in this world, is to use deception. Satan is a deceiver. He's a master deceiver. And the first part of his strategy is to use deception to make you believe that he does not even exist, to hide behind human beings to do his evil work. He has human beings to go in the front and do his evil work, and he hides behind. And you don't realize that he is the one at work, and you begin to fight human beings, your brother and sister in the church. Some of us begin to fight our own family members. Some of us begin to fight our co-workers and people like that. But the truth of the matter is that the battle, the power that God has given us, is not meant to be used against our brothers and sisters, and not meant to be used against human beings who were created in the image of God. But the power that God has given us is meant to be used against Satan, who is our main enemy. The first part of Satan's two-part strategy is deception. He's a deceiver. But the second part of Satan's two-part strategy is demonic. He uses deception and he uses demons. Demons are evil spirits that God casts out of heaven when he casts Satan out. And those demons are in this world. And Satan uses demons to do his diabolical work. And Paul tells us about those demons. He called them principalities. He called them power. He called them the rulers of the darkness of this age. He called them spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Let me tell you first of all what he means by the fact that they are principalities. A principality is a person that is put over a particular geographical area. And what he says that Satan has demons that are principalities. He has demons that he has assigned to certain places. He has the ones he has assigned to America. He has the ones that he has assigned to Africa. He has the ones that he has assigned to a particular country. Then Satan has principalities. These are demonic powers which he has assigned to specific geographic areas. But not only does he have principalities, but with these principalities, he also works with powers. Powers are those to whom Satan has delegated, he has delegated his satanic powers, if you will. So he has the demons and he has delegated to them powers to do evil. And they are capable of doing a lot. In case you don't know, ask Job the power of demons. And Job will tell you that a demon can take life because the demons took his children. He will tell you that demons can scatter your business, that business you have built all the days of your life, and you have made it the center of your life. Satan can reduce it to zero and overnight through his demonic powers. Satan has powers. He can bring sickness to people's lives. That's why some people have sicknesses. They go to the doctor. The doctor cannot explain what is wrong with them. Their MRI is good. Their CAT scan is good. Their PET scan is good. Their ultra-PET scan is good. Their ultrasound is good. Everything is good, but they are still not well. And nobody knows why they are not well. Listen, Satan has demonic powers. And one of the things they are capable of doing is they are capable of afflicting with sickness. But not only does he call them principalities and powers, but he calls them also rulers of the darkness of this age. He has demons that operate in darkness. They seek darkness in the world. They pull the blanket of darkness all over the world. And they prevent people from coming to the light to know the true and the living God. And I want you to know that they are those, and some of them, the Bible described them as angels of light. They had churches. They preached behind pulpits. They wear nice pastoral robes or suits. But they are keeping people in darkness instead of bringing people to the light of Jesus Christ. And they are inspired by nobody but Satan himself. Paul said to the church at Ephesus that every believer has persecutors in this world. He has those that are planning evil in this world. And it includes Satan and the demons. Then finally, Paul described those demons as spiritual hosts of wickedness in heavenly places. Do you know what a host is? A host is an army. So he says that Satan has his demons arranged and organized as an army. And their job is to do wickedness in the world. Their job is to bring evil wherever they can go in. And Paul says to the church at Ephesus, stop fighting your brother or your sister in the church. Don't quarrel with your wife that seems like it will never end. Why don't you stop it today? Yeah. If you are going to be married to a person, you are sleeping on the same bed with them, why will you be quarreling with them all the days of your life? Yeah. God hasn't, it is not the will of God for us to spend our powers fighting against people when our real enemy is the devil and the demons. Some of you have trouble on your job. But your real problem is not your boss. Some of us, we can't get over the situation because we keep fighting the wrong person. Yes, but Paul said to the church at Ephesus, he said to them that we, every believer has power in this evil. But every believer has, not only do we have power, but every believer also has persecutors in this evil world. We have power, but we have to use our power in the right place and against the right person. It is wrong for those who have donned the uniform of our police officers to take the lives of innocent citizens. No, if they took the life of criminals, those engaged in criminal activities, we understand. But to take the life of family people, just doing their jobs, going about their business. The last time I checked, it's not a capital offense in America to sell CDs. We have chosen in America that we like guns, that people should carry guns. It's not a capital offense for a person to carry a gun in the same state that said that guns are allowed. Why should they then, why should Philando Castile die? Why should he be shot and killed because he's carrying a gun in the same state that said he can't carry a gun? Listen, church, if we don't know how to use the authority that God has given us, we will abuse it. We will use it to harm the innocent. Why should somebody wake up one day and take up a gun and shoot my police officer? The fathers of children, the husbands of wives, whom he does not know, who have never done him any harm. He had the power of a gun in his hand, but he misused that power. The Bible says that we should not misuse our power as children of God. And anytime you use the power that God has given you against your brother and sister in Christ, anytime you use it against any other person,
that you are not doing the will of God, you are abusing the power that God has given you. So in our testimony, that every believer has power in this world. But every believer has persecutors in this evil world. And we ought to direct our power at our persecutors. Let me close by sharing with us that every believer has provisions in this evil world. In verses 13 through 20, I'm just going to go through it quickly. The Bible tells us that God has given us some provisions. He has given us some things that we need because we live in an evil world. Because Satan is against us. Because Satan is planning evil for your life, young people. God has given you some things, some provisions to help you to overcome the evil that is in the world. He has given us the ability to resist the devil. And he has also given us the ability to repel the devil. There is a difference. He has given us some weapons that we will use to resist the devil. Then he has given us some weapons to repel the devil. That is to drive the devil far away from us. And in the text, Paul tells us about the weapons that God has given us to resist the devil. He talks about them. He said, first of all, God has given us the girdle of truth. He said, God has given us the breastplate of righteousness. That God has given us the gospel of peace. God has given us the shield of faith. And God has given us the helmet of salvation. God has given us the truth. You see, when you know the truth, Satan will not be able to deceive you. When you know the truth that is in the Word of God, you will not be deceived. So God has given you a weapon with which to resist the devil. And that weapon is the truth of the Word, which is in the Holy Bible. Church, you need to know the truth. Young people, you need to know the truth. If you don't know the truth, Satan will deceive you. Satan deceives grown people, talkless of little children. The Bible says that God has given you the truth. Pay attention in Bible study. Pay attention in Sunday school. Because when you go out, you are going to encounter evil. And Satan will try to deceive you, and you will be successful if you don't know the truth. The Bible said not only has he given us the girdle of truth, but he has also given us, according to the Bible, the breastplate of righteousness. He has given us righteousness. And we know that righteousness comes through our Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible said that he who knew no sin, that he became sin for us, that we may become the righteousness of God in him. God has given us the breastplate of righteousness. What that means is that through Jesus Christ, we have received the real righteousness. The Bible said in a place, it said that there is none righteous, no, not one. What that means is that there is no righteousness in me, there is no righteousness in you, there is no righteousness in any one of us. The only righteousness that we have, the real righteousness, is the righteousness of Christ. And one of the ways you fall into the traps of the enemy, when you start trying to create your own righteousness. That is the problem that America is facing today. America is trying to create its own righteousness. They are saying, put the Bible aside. Stop talking about Jesus. Stop talking about the Word of God. We know what is righteous. Our America is trying to create its own righteousness. But real righteousness comes from God. And it is in the person of Jesus Christ. So God has given us the breastplate of righteousness. He has given it to us so that we can defend against the devil. We can resist him. When Satan tries to deceive you, to say, I am right. You know, I've seen a lot of young people today. One of the popular things about young people, they say, this is my truth. This is my truth. In other words, this is how I see it. But the Bible said that the word of God is forever settled in heaven. There is no such thing as your truth. The Bible says that Jesus Christ is the way, he is the truth, and he is the life. Truth is not relative. It doesn't depend on what you think. You know that story about that professor in Harvard? There was a professor in Harvard, he had read a few books. So he came up with the idea, he said that there is nothing like truth. And so when he announced it in class, that there is nothing like truth, there is nothing that is absolute in morality. The Bible says that, the story says that one of his children, the students in his class, got up and walked to the front of the class, got to the professor and punched the professor in his nose. And when he punched him in his nose, the professor said, ouch! Why did you do that? The man said, there was nothing wrong in what I did, because he said there is no truth. There is no absolute morality. I punched you in the nose because it felt right to me. It was my truth. Young people, forget that garbage. Forget that garbage. There is truth in this world. And the truth is in the Lord Jesus Christ. God has given us weapons to resist the devil. And he has given us the breastplate of righteousness. Real righteousness comes from Jesus Christ. But he has also given us the gospel of peace. He has given us the gospel of peace, that we are at peace. The gospel of peace is the good news of peace. The good news of peace that comes through Jesus Christ. You see, we live in a world that is troubled. There is trouble everywhere. There is evil everywhere. There is bad news everywhere. But in the midst of all of the bad news, God looked upon us, had mercy on us, and he gave us good news. He said that I have given you the gospel of peace. He has given you the good news that there is peace. And that peace is in Jesus Christ, his son, who is the Prince of Peace. If you want peace in your life, turn to Jesus. If you want peace in your family, turn to Jesus. If you want peace in your marriage, Jesus is the answer. If you want peace in the nation, Jesus is the answer. You want peace in the world, Jesus is the answer. God has given us the preparation of the gospel of peace. But he has also given us the shield of faith and the helmet of salvation. These are the things he has given us so that we may resist the devil. He said he has given you the shield of faith, so that Satan will not lie to you. You see, Satan will come to you and tell you that everything that the Bible said is true is not true. And he will tell you the reason it is not true is because you have not seen it yet. He will tell you that Jesus said he's coming back, but 2,000 years have passed and he has not come back yet. He will tell you not to believe it, but God has given you the shield of faith. He has given you the shield of faith. And with the shield of faith, you say, yes, I know that I haven't seen it, but I believe it. Yes, I know that I haven't seen it, but I believe it. Yes, I know that I have not received my breakthrough, but I believe it. Yes, I know that things are not as well as they are ought to be in my family, but I believe the word of God, that if I trust God, he will bless my marriage. The Bible said that he that findeth a wife findeth a good thing. God did not give you a wife to curse you. I just want you to know that he that findeth a wife findeth a good thing. I don't care about how things are, but I believe it. I believe it. I believe the word of God because I have the shield of faith. Whatever Satan may devise, whatever lies that he may tell, I thank God that I have the shield of faith and we have it on our side. And most of all, he said he's giving you the helmet of salvation. He has given you the helmet of salvation so that you may know. The helmet goes on the head so that you may know in your mind that I'm heaven bound. It does not matter what lies Satan may tell. It does not matter how difficult this world may get. It does not matter how much evil may be wrought and shed in the world. I know that I know that I know that heaven is my eternal home. How do you know that, Pastor? Because I have put on the helmet of salvation. I'm not going to fall for Satan's deceits. Because I know that this world is not my home. I'm just passing through. That my treasures are laid up somewhere beyond the roof. That the angels beckon me from heaven's open door. And I can't feel at home in this world anymore. I have to tell you that God has given us some things so that we will resist the devil in this evil war. But he did only give us some weapons to resist the devil. But he gave us some weapons so that we can repel the devil. You know what it means to resist? Resist means that when he attacks us, he cannot be successful. But the Bible says that God has given us some other weapons. He has given us some weapons to drive him away. Not only do I want to resist him, but I want to drive him away. I don't know if this mic is working, but I just know that I don't only want to resist him, but I want to drive him away. I'm tired of him coming into my family. I'm tired of him coming into my heart. Into my job. I'm tired of him coming into our school. And God gave us some weapons. Not only to resist him, but he gave us some weapons and to repel him. To drive him out from our homes. Drive him out from our face. And the Bible says that Jesus Christ, when Satan came to attack him, Jesus Christ resisted him. But Jesus Christ drove him away. He drove him away with the word of God. The Bible said we have the Son of the Spirit, which is the word of God. So begin connected to the word of God. Listen, stop praying those type of prayers. They are baby prayers and they don't work. But I'm trying to tell you that you have to pray with the word of God. It is the sword of the spirit. Christ, Satan away. Drive him far from you with the word of God. Our Lord Jesus Christ is who the world needs. The Prince of Peace. The desire of the nations. Jesus Christ. The Lily of the Valley. The Bright and the Morning Star. The Son of Righteousness. The Horse Oil in the Valley. The Stone hewn out of the Mountain. I'm talking about Jesus. Mary's Baby. God's Son. The Blessed and the Omnipotent. Full of grace and truth. I'm talking about Jesus. I'm talking about the healer. I'm talking about Jesus. The Bible says he's above all principality. I'm talking about Jesus, whom to whom God has given all power in heaven and earth. I'm talking about Jesus, whom God has exalted and given him a name that is above all. And that power is what he has made available to you. Why are you as a Christian living a powerless life, praying useless prayers that are not connected to God's word, and they don't work? Listen, you better know the word of God so you can use it to pray in your heart. Amen. Amen. Go from room to room. Drive every demon out with God's word. Amen. Amen. Pray on your children when they go out. Some of them are still young. They don't know that the world is dangerous. They'll find out later on. But until then, pray. Pray for them as they go. So that Satan will not deceive them and destroy their lives. The world needs Jesus. The world needs Jesus. The world needs Jesus. Our nations need Jesus. Our leaders need Jesus. They don't know what to do. How I wish they would turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. Oh, how I wish they would turn to the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.